Vacation and all the way back down to Grundy. So I have about 10 counties that I oversee. The commission, we don't do direct services. However, we do provide oversights as well as policy recommendations for all child serving agencies in the state. And we are heavy in youth justice. Youth justice is our baby. So I'm going to try to share this PowerPoint. So hopefully, fingers crossed, it works.
Oh, there it is.
Yay. Okay. You have to love technology.
Very, very good.
Okay. So, and I meant to say one of the things that the commission does very well is our building strong brains work. We take pride in the fact that we kind of helped with pushing that trauma-informed care and ACEs out into the communities in our beautiful state of Tennessee. We've been trying to do this work for a little over 30 years. So we decided to roll out the resiliency portion in 2022, I think early 2022. So it was like right after COVID hit, we knew that there was going to be well, a lot of trauma, ACEs. And we knew we had to do something. So then we rolled out the resiliency portion of it. And I tell people all the time, resiliency is one of those things where it's like you either have it or you don't. You either can find it or you can't. But every child is one caring adult away from being a success story. So, and honestly, all it takes is that little bit of resiliency. So let's go ahead and get started. If my computer wants to cooperate. So I want to always talk about, of course, I'm going to say ACEs, and I hope you guys know what that means, but it's the outburst childhood experiences. And I know back in the day, in the 90s, there was a survey that was sent out, and it talked about all these things that could happen before a child became an adult or age 18 and how that would have adverse health effects. So you would see so kids that were coming out of abusive situations or abusive homes, individuals that were involved in drug use or having family members that were mentally ill or anything like that. We considered those an adverse childhood experience, right? So we did all or they did all that study. And they found out, like within ACEs, or the study of the average childhood experiences, that you have, I think it was three or more ACEs, you were going to have some significant health problem. So, whether that was diabetes, high blood pressure, fibromyalgia, like any of the, we call them the autoimmune diseases. We were seeing a lot of autoimmune diseases come from individuals that had experienced or had high ACE scores. So that's a little bit about ACEs. And I'm sorry, I'm gonna grab a quick drink of water because it's allergy season for me. I don't know about anybody else, but it's definitely allergy season for me. Okay. So this is one of my favorite quotes, because it's true. So we know that if we do the work beforehand, we won't have to do so much work at the end, right? So if we can really pour into our babies, and I say babies as kids of all ages. I have a 21-year-old daughter and she's still my baby. So when I say babies, I mean kids of all ages. But if we pour into them now, we'll be able, or they'll be so successful later on. They'll be able to bounce back from bad situations or be able to put pour into the next generation, right? But we have to do that early on. So trauma is a one size, it's not a one size fit all type thing. Trauma is, it happens to everybody. And we figured that, we found that out with COVID, right? Like that was a traumatic experience and everybody went through COVID. So trauma is one of those things that it, you don't have to find it, it's going to find you. So it's a life-altering event. And like I said, it's not one size fit all. So what's life-altering to me may not be life-altering to you. And so when we talk about trauma and we talk about resiliency, it's like building a house, right? There has to be a good foundation. And if there's a good foundation, which includes some of these things that are on your screen, which is having healthy relationships, being able to have like that strong community around you, whether that's in your home or even literally like just a strong community, a strong support, because it does take a village. But if we have those things, right, if we have those things in place, then kids can bounce back from bad things. Individuals or people can bounce back from bad things because we have that foundation. We have that steady, consistent love and care. So bad things don't hurt for too long, if that makes sense. And please stop me anytime if you have any questions. So like I said, we have the brain is a very beautiful, unique, and kind of, I call it magical, because it is one of those things that it can protect you from yourself. It can help you forget things that are harmful. It can shut down when it needs to. Like, it's just an amazing organ, right? So one of the things about the brain is that when we have trauma or we have bad things that occur, it stops us, right? Our brain will stop us right where that bad thing happened. And you can grow and everything else can change around you and you can get grown, but then you're still having those past trauma events that are still in your brain. They're still there. And that has stopped your brain development in some areas because that was never healed, right? So when we talk about resiliency, we have to go back and look at that trauma and pour into that child at that age, that time frame. So if I am 12 and something really bad happens to me at 12, I may grow up to be 35, 36, 40, and I look like a grown adult, but I still can't handle things. And I can't handle some things as a 40-year-old. I'm handling them as a 12-year-old. So we see a lot of individuals that say, we say they're childish. Or we say like, oh, why are they grown-ups throwing full tantrums? Well, 9 times out of 10, something happened and they were never able to kind of connect those other pieces of thoughts together. That higher functioning never develops quite so well. So you're going to have that lack of impulse control and you're going to have that lack of higher reasoning, because it's the frontal lobe that really gets damaged. And that's where we have that higher reasoning. That's when we have that, let me think about the consequences before I do this action. So one of the things that we can do as adults is provide that type of stability, because like I said, bad things are going to happen, but we have to be able to kind of balance them, right? We have to be able to do the little teeter-totter. Yes, bad things are going to happen, but there's some resiliency. So we have to pour in the good just as much as we have the bad that happens, because toxic stress will derail a healthy person. I know we're talking about resiliency and I work with the children and youth, but when we talk about toxic stress can derail anyone. So we build resiliency by improving the serve and return. Like I said, we balance it out. We know that trauma is going to happen. We know that bad things are going to happen, but we have to be able to show the good as well. I tell people all the time that I use the bootstraps analogy, if you guys have heard of that, but resiliency are the bootstraps. That's when people are saying you got to pick yourself up by the bootstraps. Resiliency, they're those bootstraps. That's the only thing that we can use to lift ourselves up. But sometimes people don't have bootstraps. Sometimes people don't have boots. And that's the struggle, right? That's when we're in toxic environments that have just overwhelmed us. They're sensory overload, just stuff that we can't move past. So then you're that one caring adult that steps in and provides those bootstraps. think we talked about this, but once again, it's just the brain architecture. It literally, you have to have that foundation. I loved Jenga as a kid, and I would always try to pull from the bottom. And one of the things that my dad would tell me was like, hey, you're messing up the foundations. Pull from the middle or pull from the top. Like, don't make the bottom so unstable. And that's, when I look at this picture, that's what it makes me think about. Because we have to have that good foundation in order to be able to build and add skills and move forward in life. So when we talk about stress, there is positive stress and tolerable stress. And I tell people when I do this, tolerable stress is are things like death in the families, and they can hurt you and they can knock you down. But depending on your level of resiliency, you should be able to get back up with the proper help and supports that you need. So positive stress is first day of school. I don't know about you guys, but I was always a ball of anxiety first day of school, especially in middle school and high school. I was always concerned about, well, who's wearing this and what looks like that. And I would have, like, my stomach would hurt. I would get nauseous and I would think I was sick. And it was just be stress. I would be a ball of nerves. My mom would hate it because I would tell her all the time, like, Mom, I think my stomach's hurting. And she was convinced I was going to have an ulcer by the time I finished high school. But I didn't. But that's the tolerable stress. So just the things that make you feel a little bit uneasy. Tolerable stress, like I said, deaths in the family, natural disasters, stuff like that. Things that we can't predict. We couldn't stop it if we tried. But those are the things that it can knock you down, and it may take you a little bit longer to get over that. But with the right care and the right support, you should be able to move through it just fine. But that toxic stress it's one of those things where you can't move past it. You can't get through it. You can't, it's nothing that you can do but deal with it or sit in it, right? And so that is what causes the brain to say, like, this isn't normal. I need to stop right here, because I can't keep going in all of this mess. So you see kids that have struggled with abuse, neglect, mental illness of a parent. Like, you see all of them, their normal is our abnormal. I did forensics in foster care for a few years, several years actually. And I had a case where this family, these kids were coming into custody, and they were so used to not having like regular running lights, water, running water, lights, bed, mattresses. Like, they'd never had that in several years. So that was not their normal. So to say, hey, you know, go to bed and actually lay in a bed, their foster family were seeing them laying on the floor and all kind of stuff. And to the foster family, it was like, well, why are they doing that? Well, that was, laying in a bed wasn't their normal. Their normal was sleeping on the floor. Their normal was not having enough to eat. Their normal was not having adequate food, shelter, and water. So their normal was not our normal. And that produced a lot of behaviors, because we were trying to force them to do something that they had no idea how to do. So they lived in a toxic environment for years. And their brain had got accustomed to that. And so now we were trying to tell them, like, that's not right. This isn't right. You're supposed to do it this way. And they were struggling with that. And this is a good slide, because it kind of shows, like, toxic stress. I tell people all the time, if you've ever been startled or frightened, I don't like scary movies because I do get frightened very easily. So toxic stress is like when you get scared and you stay scared. Like, you just stay scared. It never levels down. It never steadies off. You're just always on pins and needles, pins and needles, pins and needles. And if you know, I don't know if you guys have ever felt anxiety or anything like that, but that does not make you feel good. If your heart is constantly racing because you don't know what's going to come next, if your stomach is always doing flips because you have no idea what's going to happen tomorrow, that toxic stress, it doesn't just affect your brain, it affects your whole body. Great segue to this slide, but it does disrupt your brain development. You can have cardiovascular and immune system issues. We see a lot of individuals that do struggle with toxic stress, with congestive heart failure, and like I said, the autoimmune diseases like lupus, fibromyalgia, a lot of those, if you did an ACE study or you did an ACE questionnaire, a lot of the individuals that do identify with those medical issues have high, significantly high ACE scores. And they always usually tend to have the, I call them the big three of the ACE scores. So there would be the sexual abuse or some type of sexual abuse that happened early in childhood, the neglectful environment, and the physical abuse. 9 times out of 10, those three or more, or at least three, would be individuals that have one or more of the physical symptoms. I'm sorry. So like I said, we talk about abuse, neglect, and household dysfunction. And I think a lot of people I get a lot of questions about mother treated violently. So one of the things that we were very shocked, including myself, to find out was that during the ACE study and with follow-up research, we found out that babies in utero are experiencing the same thing that mommy's going through. So although we're saying that the baby's not here yet, the baby is, you know, they don't know what's going on. They do, because babies in mommy's bellies feel everything. They hear it, they feel it, and they know when mommy's not okay. So then we have those babies that are coming out that are just not able to be soothed. And a lot of them will call them drug babies. But now we're starting to see that some of those babies that can't be soothed are babies that were in mommy's belly and mommy was in a stable environment. So it starts early on. And so this is what I was talking about with the brain development. So one of the things that I like to stress is the frontal lobe. So the frontal part of the brain, like I said, is at higher functioning. It is where you see that impulsivity control. It's where you see the let me think about the consequences of my actions. Like that part of the brain is here. So we know that the part of that brain that it doesn't fully develop until later on in life. So I think for girls, it's early 20s. For boys, it could be a little later than that, right? But if we're having situations that are stunting this and closing off the connections that are right here. So if we have trauma affects the amygdala. So it's this part of the brain. So if we have trauma, then that means that there's nothing firing to the frontal lobe, right? There's no, I usually have a big diagram, but I forgot it at office. So, but there's nothing firing to make those connect. So if we have a stunted development of the frontal lobe, you're going to see that risky behavior, that crime, early kid crimes. You're going to see impulsivity control. So kids that have, I tell people all the time, especially in a school setting, kids that have, that are diagnosed ADHD, do a UCLA on them. Do a PTSD screener on it and see if they have PTSD, which is post-traumatic stress disorder. See if there's some PTSD in there that can be masking as ADHD. And 9 times out of 10, you're going to have a high UCLA as well as, you know, maybe a high A score. And so then you have to ask those questions like, is this really impulsivity? Is this really ADHD or ADD? Or is this really a kid that doesn't have the connections to help function or help the frontal lobe function appropriately? Like I said, these are some of the problems that you would see with individuals that have the high A scores because you're going to see those social problems and increase health and social problems. And like I said, the social problems would be going to juvenile or going into custody, youth justice, or going into having to go into a mental institution. And to be honest, Tennessee does not have a lot of resources for our kids that are struggling with that. Another thing about toxic stress. So like I said, cognitive attention behavior, like all of those are direct correlation with toxic stress and having to be in that for long periods of time. I love this slide because it's really true. I think yesterday I was reading an article in the Times about how our bodies store our pain. So even if it's not happening to us anymore, you can still feel it, like you're having sympathy pains, right? Have you seen someone close their finger in the door and you're just like, oh, I know that hurt. And maybe sometimes you can actually feel it. It's because our body has stored that memory. The epigenetics is a whole thing that I love, but it really just talks about how, like I said, the things that our kids or our babies experience in mommy's belly, it's kind of like epigenetics. So epigenetics are things that are stored and passed on through our DNA. So we're seeing that correlation with toxic stress. We're seeing that with ACEs. We're seeing that, I think back in the day, they used to call them generational curses. Well, it kind of is, but it's really just epigenetics. What happened to my mom is probably going to happen to me. 9 times out of 10 is going to be because she raised me a certain way, so I'm going to raise my kids that way. But it's also going to be just how our genetics. So when you say, like you hear people say that, hey, we have a predisposition to alcoholism or stuff like that, like that's an epigenetics. That's a good example of epigenetics. So these are a pair of ACEs that are on a community or environmental level. And I like to see, I love that they have added the ones underneath the roots, because that's when you see the community, right? You remember initially I said at the beginning of this, I said that all our kids are one caring adult away from being a success story. And this shows that. So when you see the domestic violence or homelessness or divorce of parents, all that's happening in the home. But the stuff below the surface, the stuff below the roots, that can happen in the community. So if we have, so for every negative thing that we have, so poverty, discrimination, community disruption, there's always a bounce back. So if we have homelessness, then let's try to get them into public housing, affordable housing. If they are struggling with education, let's try to work with Boys and Girls Club to get them some services. All of those can be resiliency factors. All of those can be something that allows a child to feel loved, wanted, and appreciated. And that is what builds resiliency. Every time you pour into a kid or in an individual, you're giving them bootstraps. So this is some data and statistics that we've had. Honestly, we pulled these in 2021, maybe, or early 2022. So I would assume that these numbers have went up. Data's always a year behind, I'm sure you know, or actually 2 years behind since COVID. But over half of the children in the United States are exposed to violence crimes. And that's not violent crimes like on video games or in movies or on TV. Like they're physically seeing that, right? 26% of those individuals will have a traumatic event happen before the age of 4. And so if we know that will happen before the age of 4, that means they're going to go into pre-K or elementary or pre-K or kindergarten, elementary school. And if they have not seen the proper therapist, they have not received the support that they need, they're going to bring that traumatic event with them to school. And what you're going to see is the behaviors of, I don't want to do this, throw the tantrums and all of that. And it's going to be because they're hurting, but they can't label it. Because I'm sorry, I'm a mommy, but I haven't met a four-year-old that can explain a traumatic event in a way that I could probably get it. I wanted to point out at the bottom that that's a real statistic. I think in the state of Tennessee, we spend over, in the state of Tennessee, we spend, I think it's $5.2 billion on problems related to child abuse and childhood trauma. And I want to say that slide might be in here. It may not, though. Oh, yeah. So this is what we spend as a state on the things that we just discussed. So the child abuse, childhood trauma, neglect, all of the ACEs. This is what we spend. And I don't know about y'all, but $3 to $5 billion is just a little bit much when we could start from the you know, we could just try a little harder in the beginning and not have to. That's a lot of money. Probably if we did that, we probably could, if we just saved a little bit, we probably could make college free for everybody. I don't know. And this is the economic impact of ACEs. And like I told you guys, the higher the ACE score, and you'll see it like 4 ACEs, 3 ACEs, the higher the ACE score, the more you're gonna have health problems. And what gets me is always the hypertension, because people think it's a diet thing, and it is. But what's funny is that it's, I eat comfort food, and I have never had comfort food that was probably the healthiest. Let me just say that. So when we talk about ACEs and trauma, I think it's because we do youth justice, we always have to bring in incarceration and what that looks like. We spend a little bit over, from start to finish with the kiddo that's going through the youth justice spend, we spend a little bit over $400,000 for one case. It only costs $9,000 for that kid to go to school. And I just like to let that sit there, because it's a lot of money. Especially when we could do the work at the beginning. Especially when we could try to be that light for them early on. So now that we're going to talk about a little bit of resiliency, we've been talking about that, but we're going to really go home on it. So fostering resiliency, it is so simple, because all you have to do is really, like I said, give them the bootstraps, be that positive and shining light for that kid, care, love them, express that they're important to you, you know, just be positive. I'm not sure if this will play. Well, it's not playing, but really this little clip is from the CDC, and it just talks about a kid that was, oh wait, hold on. Fingers crossed.
This is my neighborhood. I grew up in this building. This is a great community now, but it's had its share of problems. When I was a kid, our community had high unemployment, a lack of resources for families, and lots of kids hanging out with no adult supervision. You might have heard about adverse childhood experiences or ACEs. ACEs are traumatic events in childhood, like abuse and neglect, that can increase risk for future problems. But they don't have to. The good news is that ACEs and their consequences can be prevented. Take me, for example. I was at risk for ACEs, and despite all the things that put me at risk, some pretty incredible people helped make sure that I wouldn't become another statistic. Come on, I'll show you around. That's Jackson. He's a cool kid. His dad left when he was 2, and his mom works 2 jobs. I hang out with him every Thursday night and help him with his homework. Sometimes we grab ice cream. It's fun. Plus, he has another adult role model to learn from and trust. That's Mr. Martino. When I was a kid, he let me help him at the store sometimes after school when my parents were working late. He did that for a bunch of us. My dad actually found his job as a mechanic because of Mr. Martino. This helped our family in so many ways. Not only did my dad have a steady paycheck, which eased his stress about paying rent and buying necessities like food and clothes, but he was also a lot nicer to me, my brother, and my mom once he started working a job that made him feel good about himself. When communities come together, they can do so much to prevent ACEs. Mr. Martino and other local business owners put together a series of career workshops to help people like my dad find work. My mom also got a job with a company that allowed her to work from home and spend more time with me and my brother. Mariana has just gotten out of a class about handling challenges of single parenting. The clinic offers free childcare so Mariana's daughter, Ella, can play while Mariana's in class. The class helps parents like Mariana develop positive parenting skills, not just for babies and toddlers, but for teenagers too. This is another way our community has come together to give families the resources they need. And just one more way to prevent ACEs. This was my school, Riverside Middle, right in the heart of town. These kids are here for a sponsored summer camp. This community-supported program helps families with affordable, quality childcare and helps kids get tutoring and learn life skills. When I was a kid, I spent a lot of time at this school all year long. There was one counselor, Miss Greer, who I remember more than anyone. She was a really good listener. Miss Greer helped me and my brother get involved in after-school activities like baseball and soccer. Our coaches were super nice and were mentors to us. Staying after school for practice kept us and a lot of other kids out of trouble. When schools help take responsibility for preventing ACEs, everybody wins. My life could have gone in a completely different direction. Studies show that ACEs can have long-term negative effects on kids' health and well-being that may last into adulthood and even continue in future generations. But by people and groups taking action, ACEs can be prevented. In fact, there are 5 known strategies that help stop ACEs before they even start. You can implement them in your own community, just like we did. How? By strengthening economic support for families. By changing social norms to support parents in positive parenting. By providing quality care and education early in life. By enhancing parenting skills to promote healthy child development. And by intervening to lessen harms and prevent future risk. So, now you know my story, and you've seen the prevention strategies in my community that helped me beat the odds. I had healthy relationships with my family and friends. I learned how to take care of myself and make good choices. And today, I'm a mentor to other kids who need some extra help so they don't become an ACEs statistic. Safe, stable, and nurturing relationships and environments are essential to prevent child abuse and neglect and to assure that all kids reach their full potential. Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Banana split? You got it.
So like that video said, we have to promote positive childhood experiences. So increasing your interaction in a positive way with any families that you come involved with or come across or involved with, even if it's just at church, the kids that you see maybe in Sunday school or who you see just walking in the parking lot, just be that positive light, trying to, because you never know what a person is going through. And our babies have just as much on their plate as we do as adults. I think we've already talked about resiliency pretty well. But it really does help with your emotional and mental health if you can have just that successful interaction with the caring individual. So the three systems of promoting resiliency. So it having that resiliency or showing that with to a baby or kid, it helps self-regulation, flexible thinking. So you see a lot of the benefits in school, right? So you'll see them being able to do those critical thinking skills. You'll see them being able to say like, oh, okay, well, it's raining outside, so I can't go outside today without having those big meltdowns. Resiliency can really just help a kid in every aspect of their life. And once again, talking about if we can, trauma happens to everyone. So if we can be that shining light, pour into that individual when we're having that stressful moment, then we can disrupt the toxic stress and let the healing begin. And that is all.
Thank you very much, Marissa. Does anyone have any questions? Okay, well, I want to thank everyone for coming tonight. That was very interesting. And some of those things I didn't know, that was very interesting. So thank you very much.
No problem. And if you guys do have any questions, you think about anything later on, then I'm sure that if you send an email to Rise Up, then I will be able to answer those.
Oh, you're welcome, Alicia. Alicia said thank you for the information. So, yes, if you have any questions, reach out. So, okay, well, I hope everyone has a good rest of their evening. Thank you again, Marissa.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.